let your praises fill my mouth. Hallelujah.
appreciate it so much. We don't know you, and you don't know us. Before this thing is over, we're going to know each other pretty good. Amen. But to kind of let you in on a little bit of who we are, I started preaching when I was 14, and my wife's parents are Assembly of God pastors, so she's a PK, and I've been an evangelist ever since I was 14, and traveled preaching the word, playing the organ, singing and preaching up under tents and auditoriums and churches from one place to another, seeing tremendous miracles, people saved, delivered, cancers disappeared, people get up and walk out of wheelchairs. And I know that that's not very popular anymore. We're not seeing a whole lot of it, but I'm going to tell you, God's still on the throne. God's still in the healing business. I believe that with all of my heart. We are from Dallas, Texas area. I've lived there my whole life. And for you older ones, if you were brought up around the full gospel ministry, I'm out of the Gospel Lighthouse Church, J.C. Hibbert's church. And I said all that to say, we're not here to play patty cake with anybody. No, I didn't drive all the way up here, across the Red River, come on somebody, to be playing church with anybody. Amen. I know that the Lord has given me something. I love it when the Lord gives me something and I don't get it. When you try to figure out what does that have to do with you, and I'm trying to figure it out and you can't. I love it when God does that, because you know that He has a right now, rhema word for somebody. So you're in the right house tonight. We don't do tricks. Sorry, we don't play. Yeah, this is genuine to us. We've been through too much hell to be playing church by now. Hello, somebody. So I want to get into a little bit of that here in just a second. I do want to say that we go through things in life with a target on our back. If you are genuinely saved and you have a calling and an anointing on your life, you may not be called to be a prophet, but if you're called by the King to do something, you have a target on your back and the enemy wants to shut you down before you get started. You understand what I'm telling you? And I'm not here to glorify the enemy, of course. I hope you understand that. But I want to tell you, if it hadn't been for God on my side, I know exactly where I'd be. I'd be dead. We're going on 9 years. We're going on 9 years. It'll be 9 years in February, won't it?
In 3 weeks.
We had an incident. The enemy pulled back his bow and arrow and aimed it at me. You know, when you're so wrapped up in God and you're not trying to sound spiritual and sticky and, you know, syrupy, but just doing what the Lord's called you to do. You got your hand on the plow and you're pushing forward. And you're so busy, you don't even recognize that the enemy is behind a bush with a bow and arrow pointing at you. Y'all understand what I'm telling you? And so we had rented a storefront, and the Lord had called me to start a full gospel church, more like a revival center, similar to what you're doing here. And the word got out. The devil heard about it, and he thought he would try to stop it. This is not a story that I tell everywhere. I've just written my book, Random House Has Called Me. I didn't call them. And so the book will be out somewhere probably in the summer. You can go to Barnes & Noble and get it. But God's really good. So you just don't know what tomorrow holds, but you need to know who holds you. So we're going out of the building because that particular night was going to be our grand opening night. And so we had to rush out of the building after vacuuming, set the chairs up and everything. And I guess just exhausted from all the work. Come back. Well, we left. I left. Got in the shower. Got out of the shower. And I couldn't see anything on the right side of me. Make a long story short, she rushes me to the hospital, only to find that there's a bleed on my brain. It's one of the veins had erupted, or actually kind of sprung a leak. And so they did surgery. They cut me open, they shaved me, cut me open, drilled, went inside, and all of those things. We get a phone call. Everything went wonderful, came out, but I get a phone call from a pastor friend of mine, and he says to my wife, I've got good news, I've got bad news, I've got some good news. Bad news is the devil's not done, and the enemy's going to try to attack again, but good news is God already has a plan.
Always.
And so, four or five nights beyond that, I fell out of the bed at the hospital. There's blood all over. It sprang another leak. This one was larger than the first one. And I ended up getting sepsis. All of my system had shut down. The only thing that was keeping me alive was a particular medicine that they have that'll keep your heart pumping for 24 hours. Once that 24-hour window is closed, there's no hope. And so everything shut down, and during that time, I ended up going to heaven and seeing Jesus. And to make a long story short, at the end of my journey, he says to me, he said, do you want to stay or do you want to go back? And I said, well, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I never thought of my wife. I didn't think of my son. I didn't think of anything. I just was consumed with him. Y'all, he's wonderful. He's beautiful. And so I'm standing there and I'm talking to him, and I said, whatever you want me to do. The next thing I know is I'm waking up in the hospital. But it's been a long trip. Stay with me. It's been a long trip to recover what the enemy tried to do. What he tried to do, he didn't get to do.
Amen.
Somebody ticked him off. Come on, church.
All right.
Amen. Somebody messed up his plan.
Yes.
And it was someone like my wife and a few others that know how to pray. That know how to intercede and really call on the Lord, and not pray with feelings.
Right.
But pray the word of God and pray in faith, knowing that God hears every prayer and he's working on our behalf. Hallelujah. I said all that to say this, we ain't playing games. That's why I said some of us have gone through too much.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. To be driving all the way up here in Oklahoma and fight cowboys and Indians.
Amen.
Talk to me. To get here, amen, and just be cute, I don't think so. But God knows where you're at. He knows what's going on. And he's taken care of you. He's done a good job so far. He's not through. He's going to continue to do it. He's not a man that he should lie. Neither the Son of Man should he repent. But he's going to finish and accomplish everything that he set out to do in your life. That doesn't mean the storms aren't coming. Doesn't mean that the phone is not going to ring with a bad report. But it does mean that long before the devil ever circled a date and put a note outside that date, this is the day I've got planned to assassinate you, God had already put a circle around that date and said, I'm going to deliver you. I'm going to bring you out. I'm going to prove that I am the only true living God. in all of the world. Am I right tonight? So, I feel Jesus. Can I pray for you? Would you stand? You're very gifted and you're very talented. Let me start out by saying, I don't know nobody in this room. Okay. You're very gifted. You're very talented. You have this aura about your presence, about your, I'm not trying to sound spooky, but there's an aura of sweetness around you. You're genuine. You're like a bottle of expensive perfume, God is saying. And some folk don't like the fragrance. But it's not the fragrance that God is concerned about. It's not about the fragrance that even that God has even given you this gift. It's about how potent it is. It's about the medicine that's beyond the fragrance. People get caught up in the smell and neglect to understand that beyond the smell, there's medicine. The smell just attracts you to the medicine, but the smell can't heal anybody. Only the medication can. And you've been through a lot of stuff. I see some trauma, some emotional trauma that you have been through. Actually, some ripples from that trauma are still trying to overtake you from time to time. Some pressures in your mind, in your emotions from time to time. Now, if I'm wrong, you tell me. Okay. I see, you know how you throw a rock out in the water and it makes rings? I see the rings going out. And the Lord is saying to me to tell you, this is the last ring you're going to deal with. You know, when the ring hits, the ripple, you know, if you're sitting on a raft, it'll kind of do this. It gets calm and still, and then all of a sudden another one. The Lord says, there's not another one coming. It's calm from now on. God's going to put something stable on the inside of you that doesn't come from books, even though books help. But it's not coming from books. It's going to come. It's being birthed from you crying before God. Instead of sitting in front of the television and watching as the world turns, you have gone to the Lord in prayer and you have sought the face of God. I see your Bible opened up and you colored all in it and marked all in it, which a lot of people today don't even do that. I see you doing your homework, and I'm also seeing you doing all this not because you're trying to be deep and trying to be spiritual. It's because your hand is reaching behind you and you've got your hand on a loved one trying to keep them from being drowned. And so the enemy wants this person, but he can't get to the person unless he comes through you. But the enemy can't get to you because God's got you. Lord, y'all are tough. Amen. So the Spirit of God is just simply saying the enemy has been lying to you and that you need to really grasp hold and understand that God has you. Just because we go through trauma and problems doesn't mean we've backslid. It doesn't mean that we've done something wrong. Really, a lot of times it's because we're doing what's right and the devil's mad. So he's trying to send a distraction. But the distraction is over. I'll link that with this, and then tell you, whoever you've been praying for, they're coming home. They're coming into the presence of God. They're going to be healed. You're holding on. Ma'am? Huh? That's good? Well, it's working. It's going to happen. It's happening right now. She and I are fourth generation Pentecostals. So we're the real deal. So I'm just telling you, the Lord has heard your cry, and God is saddling up his angelic force, and they're coming to rescue you and your household.
Hallelujah.
It's done. To Jesus be the glory. Come on, let's praise him tonight. Hallelujah. Come on, let's glorify him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I told the Lord a long time ago, and I tell him quite often still, don't let me make stuff up. I want it to be real. Just let it be real. I see you, sir, as a businessman. You're wearing a camouflage jacket, but before my eyes really zoomed in and I recognized what you're wearing, I saw you earlier and your skin was camouflaged. And the Lord said to tell you that he has not only covered you, but he has hidden you. The enemy wants to assassinate you as well. Y'all do know the devil does not like the saints of God. Y'all understand that? That's a good thing. Amen. It's when the devil starts liking you, you need to go to running. Amen. So the enemy has been after you, but he's been after you, and this is what I'm hearing, he's really been after you and your finances. He's really been trying to damper your finances and hinder you in the pocket area. Because you have said in your heart, Lord, if you just give me some money, I will just build the kingdom. I will just support. I'll do whatever you want me to do, and I can't do it if you don't give me money to do it. Am I right or wrong? Okay. Well, just, can I teach y'all something? Just to be able to take this and know this Dallas boy does not know you. I've pinned it right where God told me to pin it. Said exactly what you're going through. And where she may be saying in her heart, yeah, but there's a little more to this. I wish you'd tell me just a little bit more. And God's saying to tell you, I've already given you the keys of the kingdom. I've already told you what I've told you. Now, why would I tell him the little bit if I'm not going to fulfill it all? I thought y'all were going to be faith people. Hello, somebody. I mean, it's like with Jesus. He's out, you know, walking. He takes the day out. He don't walk around the block. He walks on water. Sees Peter and says, hey, Lord, if it's really you, bid me come. And Jesus said, come. He didn't throw him a handbook to spend about 30 seconds on how to walk on water. He just said, come. Peter did not walk on water. He didn't walk on water. He walked on the word, come. Whatever the Lord told him, that's what he stood on. Our problem is we forget what we're standing on. Some folk don't even understand what they're standing on. Come on, talk to me. I mean, the Lord's all around you. You're still looking for something else. God's already done it. He's already provided. He's making a way. You're still looking for Ed McMahon to call you. He ain't calling you. God is our source. You know, we say, well, you Lord, if you just send in a couple of millionaires, we've been floating fine without anybody. Okay, so I said all that for everybody, but this is for you. Be a good steward. Be faithful with your tithe. Be faithful in your giving. Be faithful. I don't know where it's coming from, but I'm seeing larger amounts of checks being written to you. Who's the woman next to you? your wife, look at her right in her eyes and say, we're going to be rich. That made her smile. But when the Lord gives you money, you don't just go blow it. You're not going to like this, probably, but you don't give everybody that's called to preach everything you got. Be sensitive of how the Lord talks to you. Are you hearing me? And the Lord will open doors. So that's what I'm seeing. It's really strong all over me. And I really fought the enemy coming over here from the hotel. But it's all cleared up, just like my wife said it was going to be. Praise the Lord. And God calls you an anointed businessman. When he picked the 12 disciples, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, five of them were entrepreneurs, already making big bucks. He called them. You look at Peter and his brother, James and his brother, and then Zebedee, which is the father of the two boys, owns a fishing company and their own boats. Calls the sons to travel with him. And the scripture teaches that Zebedee kept the business running and funded the gospel. So I don't know what you do, but whatever it is, God's got his hand all in it. Look at him as your business partner. This bump that's in the road that you're dealing with. In just a few days, it's going to go away. It's going to disappear. You cannot buy God, but you can take your seed or your offering with the right spirit and obey God and take it and apply it against what the enemy's trying to do. Y'all not hearing me now? And defeat the attack of the enemy simply by obeying God. Amen. One more and then I'm going to tell you what the Lord told me. Young man, you are unusual. You are ridiculously unusual. Which is a good thing, because that's what God wanted. You're exactly what the Lord wants. I keep asking the Lord, Lord, when are you coming back to get us? I'm ready. You know, sometimes your people get on my last nerve, and I'm ready for us to all get out of here. Come on, somebody. No, y'all don't be pulling no religious stuff on me. I'm as real as they come. Amen. And with everything that's going on in the world, several people have asked me, do you think Jesus is coming? Do you think he's coming right, like really soon? I said, well, I'm going to do what I've always done, and I'm going to live every day as if he's coming back that day. And if it doesn't, I'm just going to keep on fishing. Say amen in here. Okay, but you have an anointing on your life for ministry. You are peculiar. You're not going to fit in to every group that you would like to be a part of. You have been set aside. You have been set apart. Are you his mother? You're his mother. You're in trouble. Because you got her as your mother. Because this woman will pull her weave off and beat you with it in Jesus' name. Are you hearing me? I don't even know this woman. I just know it in the spirit. She ain't playing games. She ain't going to turn you over to the devil. Oh, no. Really, God is blessed because you're a sweetheart. But I want you to take the time and not just play games. But really get serious with God. Really become close to him, because God has a real work for you to do. You may not make it to be my age. Jesus could come back before you are my age. So you need to go, you need to do what he called you to do, start now. Amen. Does that make sense? Are you called to preach? You don't know, maybe? Probably. I say you are. Your grandma say you are. Looks like you are. But you got to figure that out. You got to find that out inside of you. And if God really has a calling on your life, which I believe He does, will you seek the Lord with all of your heart and really be sincere with the Lord and be real with Him? He'll show you. Okay? He'll crawl up in bed with you, pull the covers up over the two of you, and cuddle with you. That's what He used to do with me when I was your age. And I'd lay in the bed and cry all night. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. Everybody put your hands in the air and let's give God glory. Come on, let's give Him glory tonight. Hallelujah. The young man that's running the sound system that's, that just grinned from ear to ponytail. The devil is not through trying to trick you. Hope you're really listening. He's trying to come up with another plan. What I love about God is if we'll listen, He will tell us that there's a storm coming before there's even clouds. So I want you to really be close to Him. Stay sensitive to Him. I appreciate your ministry, but don't get so caught up in all of that stuff that you're just doing the business side of it. Stay intimate with the Lord. God moves on you. Throw your hand in the air and your ponytail in the air and just praise God. Be you. There's nothing wrong with you. That's what I'm hearing the Lord say. You're genuine, you're real, and that's why the devil doesn't like you. And he's tried to trick you not long ago. Am I right? All right. And it was going to be a good one, but it didn't. He didn't make it. So he does like we always know he does. If I can't get him today, I'll get him next week. I'm not saying for you to live in fear, but live in faith, but live on guard, knowing you're carrying the mantle of God all your life. Amen. That's how ironic. The Lord is telling me to tell you, this is what got Samson in trouble. Your power is not in your hair, but the power that you do have is in your spirit and in your heart. And he lost his because he became too familiar with people that were coming around him. And he neglected to keep close what God said was holy to him. And thought, it's no big deal. They're just my friends. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? Okay. How old are you? 17? 19?
19.
If you do it right and obey God, follow what the Lord has got before you, I'll say it this way. There's a big chance that you will run your own television station. Because I see cameras and all kinds of stuff all around you. And I don't do that, do I? I've never told anybody that. You never know. It's funny because we tend to be closed-minded. So when God gives us this, then you see yourself back there with cameras. When God says, that's not what He was talking about. Who's to say that the lambs don't find out about you later on, and you have to move to Dallas and work for Daystar? You never know. You never know what tomorrow holds. But when you're doing what God tells you to do, He got more for you than you got planned. Say amen. No wonder the devil trying to mess with you. Come on, clap your hands and give Him glory. Go with with me to the 7th chapter. I'm not going to be long with this. My wife doesn't like me when I say that because it usually means I'm going to go forever. 17th chapter of the book of 1 Kings, verse 8. And when you find it, just say amen, and then I'm going to talk to you a second. First Kings chapter 17, and the story that I want to talk about for a moment is it begins in verse 8. Have you found it? Amen. Okay, now look at me. God will always have a mouthpiece. He will never fill the mouth of a fool. Now, he will use a fool for his own benefit. You know that there are false prophets and there are true prophets. It's a shame, it's really true though, that a lot of people do not know the difference, and they get themselves in trouble by following false prophets, thinking that just because you can make dust fly, that you must really have the power. This is one of the signs of the end times, that the enemy clothed in the Antichrist body is going to do signs and wonders, call fire down from heaven, come on, talk to me, do all these great miracles and cause people to be in awe and think because he does these things, he must be of God. He's a trickster. But he can't trick those who are in right relationship with God. How do you know that? Because Jesus said, "My sheep know my voice." And the voice of a stranger, they'll hear it, but they won't obey it. Because they'll know that even though the tone is almost the same, there's something missing. There's something not right. I'm about to feel God all over me. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? Listen, we've come through a lot of stuff. The church has been through a lot of things and have been brokenhearted and been misled because people have got caught up in stuff, churchy stuff, religious stuff, goosebumps. You hear me? My wife can rake her nails across a chalkboard and that'll give me goosebumps. They don't mean it's the Holy Ghost. Talk to me. I've seen people fall out under the power, but it wasn't the Holy Ghost. I've seen demon-possessed people fall out under the power of the devil, because they couldn't handle the power of God. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? So, Elijah is a prophet, and let me just say it my way, he's a prophet who don't play. Can you imagine what it would be like if Elijah were to be alive and book revivals in our churches these days? The saints would stay home and watch television because God would tell him all their stuff. While all the people who are covered under the blood will continue to have him back, those who are playing church will look for rocks to throw them at him. Okay, so we understand that. But a true prophet is one who does not alter the word of God, no matter if there's 2 or 2,000 who stand before in front of him, because what God is saying to only one is just as powerful as if it was 100,000 people. And so he is not working for the church. He or she, in this case, this prophet is a he. He's working for God. God is his boss. You don't want to tick him off. Say amen, everybody.
Amen.
Okay, so the prophet is a powerful man of God. I mean, you don't mess. Intercession. I'm not going to go deep with it right now because it takes a while, but a lot of people talk about intercession, and it's funny to me because a lot of people that talk about intercession really has no clue what it is. They think it's just a bunch of moaning and carrying on. Just noise. It's more than noise. When it starts pulling your belly button and your gut, and you're not doing it, you're so broken and so hurt and so loaded with burden. It's pulling you from within out. So like, just because I make the sound doesn't mean it's real. But when it's real, like you've done the real over this child. And I'm telling you, mama, your child is coming home. Lift your hands up. I see demons falling off of that. Off of that kid. When I said that, I just saw him. Woo! I come in agreement with you in the name of Jesus that every stronghold and every device of the enemy that's got this child bound, I rebuke you by the power of the Holy Ghost and every force of hell back up in Jesus' name. I take authority over you in Jesus' name right now by the power of the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name. Come on, help me give God glory in this house. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hands up for 60 seconds. Just worship him out loud. Louder. 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 Thank you. visualize me picking a chair up from back there and bringing it up here and sitting it in your lap. And then taking a man and setting him in the chair. And you're trying to carry this chair and this man around the room. On me, the Lord saying, because I care, not that I just love you, but I'm taking care. That's what that literally means. Cast your cares on me because I'm taking care of it. Your oil runs deep because you've had much turbulence. Show you something. It's been rough. That you operate in. You just pinpoint certain things. Because I didn't gripe, I prayed. I didn't spend a whole lot of time in front of the television, I stayed in the Lord. Okay, so now I'm going to tell you, people think you're kooky. They think that you are too spiritual and that you are trying to be flaky deep. These are my words. I want to tell you tonight, they're jealous. They're trying to figure you out. They'll never figure you out because you're walking in the divine. And the unholy or the carnal, according to the word, the carnal mind cannot understand the things of the spirit. There's no way in the world. I mean, you are soaked. You are soaked in prayer. I see you soaked in prayer. If it weren't for your prayer life, people that are closest to you would have died more than twice. I don't know who this man is that I'm seeing, but I'm telling you, this man needs to kiss your feet. Because if it hadn't been for you begging and pleading the blood and tell the Lord, Lord, don't kill him, tonight's your night. Tonight's your night. God's going to pour in fresh oil, fresh strength. Ooh, her glasses are fogging up. Come on, let's give God glory. When I lay my hand on you, the glory is going to hit you. Come on, let's give God glory in this place. Hallelujah. Let's praise him in this house. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God is really using you and your husband.
Yes.
I didn't say that for everybody to go, yes. But I don't know, because I know one pastor from this area. Not really from this area. He's from Dallas. He's a pastor friend of mine who took a church, didn't take it, they handed it to him. And it was predominantly a white church, and he is a black preacher from Dallas. And so he's pastoring in Dallas and was pastoring this one up here. That's the only connection, the only people I know up here. So, you know, this Tommy Drum, Dickie. God, why did you invite me here? I still don't know.
God.
Yeah, God. But come here and stand right there. The Lord's telling me to tell you that He's going to preserve you.
Thank you, Lord.
Because the enemy would like to snuff you out. I'm not one of those preachers that knows stuff of the flesh and acts like God told me. I got enough to fight the devil than to have God get all over me too. So I just don't play games. I'm an honest person. So when we pulled up and I noticed your business next door, I thought, isn't that amazing? I was just sitting there saying, isn't that amazing that he sells insurance in the natural, but he also is selling insurance in the spirit? Which means you got the flesh and the spirit covered. And but for you to get insurance, you got to apply to the policy. And while this has started, you hadn't told me nothing, but while this started more it's not really the word I want to use, an offshoot. It's a helping hand to the local church, to whoever wants to come and just get extra. Okay. Who wants to get cake? Because a lot of churches anymore aren't serving dessert anymore. But anyway, that's why the church anymore ain't fat. Never mind, we'll keep on going. But there is a little something, and I've not been able to really put my whole hand on it, but there's a little something that, I'll put it this way, wouldn't it be something if this ended up turning into an actual full-blown church? Because the two of you are qualified to pastor. That's what I heard. And though you have fought it, you have fought it greatly, because there are two main reasons that's coming to you why you fight it. Number one, you fight it because you really love the pastors in the community. You don't want them to think bad of you when three of them already do. But you're not robbing the church by being camped here. You're providing insurance. Okay, y'all didn't get it. Now, if we'd have done that at my church, three people would have jumped out in the aisle and shouted. But anyway, you already have a core group of sheep that will follow you. So let's take the sheet off this thing and go. You already got your church. You already got sheep. All you got to do is just accept the fact that the Lord's called you to pastor. Now, when he called me to pastor, I tell the Lord, you're nuts. Now, don't be mad at me when I tell you this, but I am an evangelist through and through. And when the Lord started dropping in my heart to be a pastor, I thought, Lord, I don't even like people. I don't like sheep. I don't take that wrong. I love you, but you understand, it's not my, I don't have the patience to babysit adults. Well, it's not wiping noses that is the other end that I'm talking about, but anyway. Yeah, well, I'm not beating around the bush tonight. But there, so you know this has got to be God, because I don't know nothing. But I, even driving up here, I'm thinking the thing, you know, is coming to me. They already have enemies. This has got to be a church. The Lord has provided. He's given them people. And he never said giving him or giving her. He always said to me, I've given them. I, force you and call a prophecy to do something that you're not released to do. But Jesus is coming and people are starving to death. And you feed people good food and they'll show up. But there are people that come and visit that they don't, we'll call it visit, but they don't go anywhere else. So they do belong to you. So really the only thing that's different is the maybe the legal term that you're not a fellowship or a church. Revival center. But when I was a little kid, W.V. Grant Sr., who pastored Souls Harbor in Dallas, he was the actual pastor of that church. And it was a revival hub, and that was the church we used to go to on Friday nights when they had Leroy Jenkins come in. They would call you out and read your underwear label back then. That's what I grew up in. And everybody thinks it's wonderful until the preacher calls them out and says, but you have provided a banquet room. God will provide the food. You're also giving a lot of your own money into this because people aren't giving like they should. If you go to a restaurant and eat and you don't pay the bill. So if you have the mentality that Jesus' food is free, you hadn't been trained right. Because anything that God gives to you is going to cost you something.
Yes.
Say amen in here.
Amen.
So, I don't know. Am I right on? Y'all saw that head. It's a difficult place to be in, and I've been there. So let me put it this way. Could it be that once you make the decision, the house will be filled? Just saying. Pray the healing balm of Gilead to come into your system and heal you so that you can continue to do what the Lord has called you to do. Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Everybody get your best offering together if you haven't given already. Everybody get your best offering in your hand. I'm not going to plead. I'm not going to do all that tonight. We're just going to stay in the river a minute and obey God. You went out hard. Life, start giving to God and give till it hurts. If you give something that you can afford, it doesn't take any faith to do it. Hello, somebody.
For me, like Jesus, no one so kind as he.
That's why I asked you the way I asked you. He ain't saved. There's no middle ground. You're either saved or you ain't. Hello, somebody. But we're going to pray that man get arrested by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
I just see his black behind in the shower. And God get in that shower with him and something come all over him. Hello, somebody. Can God do it?
Yes.
Yes, he can. What's his name? Seth. Oh, he got the wrong name. Seth. Jesus, sick Seth with the Holy Ghost. Drag him in, kicking and screaming if you got to. Bring him in Jesus' name. And I give you the glory for it. I said I give you the glory for it. I give you the glory like it's already done. Hallelujah. Thank you for letting us be a part of your ministry and your life. Amen. We're really looking forward to what God, I don't know what he's doing, but he's doing, it's like there's something up his sleeve. You gonna make it? Yes, you are.
Stand up, since we've been standing. That was a powerful word. How many got something out of that? Yes, I think you ministered to everyone in the house. If you didn't get something, raise your hand. See, we got everyone in the house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, let's close this in prayer. Father God, in Jesus' name, we thank you for this time together. We thank you, Father God, for the word that the man of God has brought to us. Father God, we pray. Your word says that we should have ears to hear and eyes to see and a heart to understand. So, Father, let us receive the word of God that has been given out. Let it go into our hearts. Let us not be a forgetful hearer, but let us be a doer of the work. And Father God, let us be blessed as we do what you have instructed us to do. Father, let us keep what we have been instructed to do by the man of God. And Father God, we pray that everything that you have spoken to us, all that you have instructed us this night, Father God, let it go down into our hearts. Let us hold on to it. And Father God, in faith, we will hang on to and we will receive everything that you have caused our heart to believe in. In Jesus' name, we say that it is done in the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. Amen. So, don't come back tomorrow night without somebody else. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. You guys be safe. Amen.
And try to trick Elijah. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, don't be messing with me either, because I'm part of them. So I read this again, and the thought came to me, why this woman that we're going to read about? Have you ever, since you've been serving God for real, ever asked the question, why me?
why is the devil picking on me and he ain't picking on the rest of these sheep? What is it about me that he won't leave me alone? Then the word of the Lord came to him, meaning Elijah, and the word of the Lord came to him saying, arise, get up, you've been here long enough, and go to Zarephath, which belongs to Zidon, and dwell there. See, I've commanded a widow woman there to provide for you. Now, listen, it is funny to me in my flesh, not in my spirit, but funny to me in my flesh, that God says to the prophet, I have provided, or I have prepared a woman that is going to sustain you. But when you talk to the woman in a few more verses, she has no clue. But God said, I have provided for you. I have talked to this woman. How is that not a lie? Because when God speaks, he reaches into the future where he's already done the work.
Yeah.
And then comes back to the present and says, it's done.
Yeah.
Much like what I told you. Because a lot of word of faith, spirit-filled, Pentecostal, whatever you want to call us, people, a lot of people only really tag it when we feel God. Ooh, that must have been the Lord. I felt him. But when are we going to grow up and recognize that though I don't feel him, I know his voice. And when God has spoken, when God has released the eternal word from his mouth into my ear, not y'all's ear, into my ear. Come on, somebody. Everybody else didn't hear it, but I heard the man when he told me, when he whispered in my spirit with a picture on a billboard driving to Oklahoma. Y'all not helping me. And I had to dodge the Cherokee people. Come on, somebody. And God then tells me out of a picture on a billboard something. It really had nothing to do with the billboard. Look at your neighbor and say, you need to get a fresh prophecy. You're living on stale bread. Some of y'all bread got worms in it. But it is amazing to me here that God is telling him, I have commanded a widow woman there to provide for you. But yet, when God said, I've commanded her, she didn't know about it. But it was already set up inside of the heart of the mind or the imagination of God. And because it's in the mind or the imagination of God, to God, it's already in reality. But because it's not driving yet, you're still waiting, praying, hoping God will do it. By his stripes... Well, Old Testament, by his stripes, you are healed. New Testament, by his stripes, you were healed. Okay. Are y'all getting this?
Yeah.
Okay, Jennifer, are you sure? So the prophet arose and went to Zarephath. I would imagine so. Since God told him the plan, it would be wrong and he would be fired and lose his anointing and his ability to read folks' mail. Come on, somebody. If you're not going to do what God's anointed you to do, then he will lift that anointing off of you. And I know a lot of preachers who had strong anointings at one time who wouldn't do what the Lord told them to do, so the Lord took the anointing and all they've been doing now is circus playing. So, you got to do balloons, something to keep the people. Y'all get it? God don't need no games, does he? So the Bible says, so he rose and went to Zarephath, just did what the Lord told her to do. When he came to the gate of the city, indeed a woman was there, a widow woman was there gathering sticks. Everybody said, oh no. He called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, meaning she did what he told him, told her to do, which says something about her character, I'm in trouble. If she had been from Oklahoma and from Texas, she would have said, you know what, buddy? There's the spigot over there. I'm in trouble. I don't have time for you. Go get your own water. Come on, somebody. But trouble has a way of bringing you to a place of decision. You're either going to go back or you're going to move forward. You're never going to be the same. You're going to either get worse or you're going to get better. I choose better. How about you? Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, that's why I'm here. I choose better. Please bring me a little cup of water that I may drink. I'm thirsty. And as she was going to get it, he called and said to her, hey, while you go, will you bring me just a little piece of bread in your hand? I'm hungry too. Now, being in the prophetic and operating under the anointing of a prophet's anointing many times, I understand this, that while you have no clue until it leaves your mouth, and once it leaves your mouth, your brain is even going, where did that come from? And when it leaves your mouth, and then they act upon it, then all of a sudden it opens almost like a chain reaction to the heavens to come open. The reason why heaven is not coming open on the house of God these days is because folk ain't doing anything. Okay. So she said, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have any bread, only a handful of flour in a bin, and a little oil in a jar. And see that I'm gathering up a couple of sticks, just two sticks. You rub them together, you're going to have some fire. If any two of you agree. Lord, some of y'all need some fire. Any two of you sticks out there, rub together. In Jesus' name, we're going to have some smoke. Someone say amen in here. She said, I'm going to go and prepare it for myself and for my son that we may eat it and die. She is preparing for her death. But God sent the man to prepare another way. While you're planning on dying, making sure your insurance policy is all paid up, and you're giving away stuff to family members that don't even like you. They're waiting for you to die. Come on, somebody. God is going, what are you doing?
Yeah, right.
This is only a ripple in the water. God, but it's a really big one. This is like a tidal wave this time. Yeah. This about knocked me over, but you're still breathing.
Amen.
Well, I just don't know if we're really doing what the Lord really set in the heart to do concerning this ministry. This is what's coming up in my spirit. But I'm going to tell you something. When I was a little kid growing up in Dallas, there was two churches other than ours that we went to, and we would go visit every now and then when they had a particular revival. It was a revival center. Back then, that's what they called them. And there was, they would have a couple evangelists come that was a part of the healing, the voice of healing ministry that I grew up in. Okay? So, when I pulled up here and began to kind of see, I don't know what you see, but I see a healing movement. I see the house filled, but it's not going to be a replay of yesteryear. It's going to have some yesteryear in it, but it's going to have some other things in it. There's some adjustments that need to take place. You've gone as far as you can go going this route. That's what God is saying. So God's going to hand you some plans, some ideas. Do you own the building? You don't own the building. Wouldn't it be wonderful if God would just hand you the building?
Amen.
Say praise the Lord in here.
Praise the Lord.
Okay. So, you know,
This is incredible. This is an incredible place. But I want you to see the place packed. I want you to see the place, and there's just everybody just laying all over the floor, everywhere. Yes. Everywhere. I want you to see piles of money and checks. Because God's going to fund what he told you to do. Yeah, but they won't ever give. That's all right. God doesn't need stingy folk. If God has to bring somebody in from Missouri and write out a check, I mean, this is God's. If it's God's, it'll do it. That doesn't mean I can just sit in the lazy chair and let him do it all by himself. You understand what I'm saying? So as long as we're praying and seeking the face of God and doing what the Lord says to do, the house is going to be filled. I see water everywhere. Wow. I mean, it's like a huge, this is not square, it's more rectangle, a rectangle swimming pool. And the water's about this deep. And I see this cute little lady, she's still trying to do her flag and she just can't because she's all in that water. Bloop, 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 bloop. Yes, it is. So she said, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have any bread, only a handful of flour in a bin, and a little oil in a jar. See, I'm gathering up a couple of sticks, and I'm going to rub them together, start a fire, and that we may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, and that we're going to eat it, and that we're going to die. I mean, my God, if you're going to die, then what's the use of going through all the trouble to making the bread and to make the fire? I mean, just go over the corner and give up the ghost. To me, for the fact that she was still trying on the edge of her life, she's gone as far as she could go, now on the edge. She's still trying. Which tells me she doesn't want to die. She wants to live. When somebody has gone through tragedy and all they got is one little thread, not a rope, it's gone down to one little needle string. You've tied a little knot at the end, you know, the kind that you know, when you thread a needle and you got to tie a knot, that's about as big as the knot has gotten. And you're hanging on. What are you hanging on to? You're hanging on to a dream. You're hanging on to a promise. You're hanging on to some hope. You're hanging on to a little word that God gave you. In the middle of the night when he woke you up and you felt God. Do y'all feel God like I feel God? Feel God all over you. Maybe you were driving and you felt the Lord hit you. And you're holding on and it has gone down to just a little tiny knot. Why does God do that? Now, y'all can shout on that all you want to, but that ain't shouting material for me. I don't like it when God takes me down to a little knot and says, okay, big boy, hang on. That's when you've got to practice on yourself what you tell everybody to do. That's when you got to call yourself out. Prophesy to yourself. Read your own mail. Say, we're not dying. We're going to live. And we're going to declare the works of God. And my latter years will be greater than my former. All right, real quick. Elijah said to her, do not fear. Go and do as I've told you to do and make me a small cake from it first. Huh. I mean, we don't have no money. You want me to take the last bit I got and give you an offering? I mean, if you only knew, we're living on scratch. God said, scratch him. We all tough up here in Oklahoma.
Say praise the Lord in here. Her obedience is what rescued them. Do you think the woman was human? Do you think the woman's human mind had, she had human reasoning? Do you think that she battled in her head and in her thoughts, I hope this works, while she's doing it? Have you ever been there? I've been there many times. I did that this afternoon coming to Oklahoma. Hello, somebody. Thank you, Jesus. But we're gonna get bread out of this meeting. Someone shout amen. Amen. Hallelujah. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of the flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the Lord sends rain upon the earth. He is prophesying not only to her that God's going to provide and meet her need, but he also wrapped up what he's about to do in the land. I'm bringing rain. I'm going to provide for you from this little jar and this little vat of oil and this little barrel of flour, and I'm going to sustain you through 3.5 years of nothing. It's going to last until the rains get here. Lord Jesus. Over in the 18th chapter, in verse 41, is when the rains come. 3.5 years of no moisture, no rain. The rivers are dried up. There's nothing to drink. When children have a fever, there's nothing to moisten their forehead in the middle of the night. Are y'all bored? Are you with me?
Yes.
What do you do when you don't know what to do? When you've done everything you know to do to stand, just stand. That word, just stand, actually means to continue to do what you've been doing until it works. So she went away and did what she did according to the word of Elijah, and she and he and her household, not just him, not just her, but everybody who came over to her house, which meant she'd go feed them for 3.5 years. I mean, if everybody else has lost their food, don't you think you'd want to make friends with that woman? I'd mow her lawn. I'd do something. So she did what the Lord told her to do. And she ate for many days, and the bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by Elijah. And I heard when I was young, growing up in church, how preachers could use this passage of scripture and say, and it was just flowing over. There was plenty, and there was just, it was just all over the kitchen, and it was in the bed. That's not what the Bible says. All right, I'm coming into my landing. This is not what the Bible says. The Bible says that whatever she needed, God's angel would make a head count. Whoever she was going to have for dinner, for breakfast, or for lunch, or snacks in between, he knew ahead of time and would count the people or know how many people she was going to serve, and it would just appear. The amount that she needed would just appear. She would use it all up and it would be empty again until she had another party. Or till the next morning that she and the boy were going to have breakfast. Come on, somebody. And the Lord put just enough. For 3.5 years, He kept her on a Holy Ghost budget. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? What are you telling me? I'm telling you tonight, by the word of the Lord, that when God is in it, He will provide. My preference is to have all the barrels overflowing. But when they're overflowing, you really don't need to use your faith. Well, that got deep right there for a couple of y'all. It's not fun to learn this, because it's fun maybe when everybody else is going through it. And you're rubbing their back, you're going to come to God's going to see you through until He's going to see you through. So it's your turn. And this time ain't nobody rubbing your back. You're all about you having to rub your own back. Get you a back scratch, Chinese back scratcher, and rub your own back, because you can't find nobody standing in agreement with you. Because you've helped everybody, but it didn't turn on you and be a blessing to you, other than the fact that God provided for His own. I would prefer for the Lord to do for us like you did for the little boy that had the 5 loaves of bread and the 2 small fish. Because when the job was concluded, there were 12 baskets heaped over that went home to the boy's house. You know, the Bible, I've heard people talking about 5,000. The Bible does say 5,000 men plus women and children. If every man had a wife and every couple had a child, there's 15,000 people at the park. And Jesus is going to feed them a fish sandwich. I would prefer to have all of that heaped over and left over. I like that story much better if the Lord would give me the opportunity to choose. But most times, He's teaching us to lean and to trust on Him, that if He said it, He'll do it. That darling just took a deep breath. Hallelujah. So, to recap a little bit of what I said earlier, I would rather for the Lord to have Ed McMahon, even if, is he still alive? I mean, whoever. The people that won all that lottery money. And drop a $20 million check in your pocket. I bet you'd shout now, wouldn't you? I'd shout, fall out, roll out. I'd do it all. I'd blow myself, catch myself. Hello, somebody. But the majority of the time, it's not that way. Is it luck? Luck had nothing to do with it. The hand of God is on your life, and He's orchestrating you. Can I do one thing before we change? I'm so glad you're getting up, because I was going to use you. Come here. Where are you going anyway? Oh, okay, go ahead. Okay, come here. So I'm going to be God, and He's going to be y'all. All right? So the Lord just does this. Amen. And it would be a lot easier for the Lord to just say, this is what I want you to do. I want you to go up there. I want you to go around. I want you to do this, do that, and then turn right, turn left, go 3 spaces, turn stop, and all that. But when the Lord's got His hand on you, and He's orchestrating and providing, thank you, baby, one step at a time, it's only fun after faith really gets a hold of you. When you wake up and realize
I'm His anyway. He's never failed me. I laid in the bed the other night. I was wrestling with the enemy. And I'm telling you, I told the devil, I said, you listen to me, you listen to me good. I was young, and now I'm a little older. I didn't go as far back as he did, but I'm a little older now. But I have never, not one time, seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging for bread. If God will do it one time, He will do it two times. If He does it three times, He'll do it 12 times. Clap your hands and shout hallelujah. If God be with you, who can be against you? God's going to see you through. Stand to your feet with me all over this room. God's going to do it. Actually, reality is that God has already done it. You're just having to walk through it. You believe it? Lift your hands. I'm going to lay my hand on your chest. And the rattle and the congestiveness and the clogging I command it to go in the name of Jesus and you to be healed. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. If you slip your hands up everywhere, just give God glory. Come on, give Him glory out loud. Thank you, Jesus. Lady, come here a minute with the sparkly hat. Not one miracle, not two miracles, not even three miracles. God said, I have provided more than three in your life, and I will continue. It'll be like an apple tree. Every time you need an apple pie, you just pick the apple off the tree. You got to make the pie. He's not going to make the pie for you, but He will provide the apple for the apple pie. Unusual ministry that you are the Lord's handmaiden, and you bring Him much joy. People who know you, they love you because you make them giggle, you make them laugh. Not that you make them laugh at you, they're laughing with you because you carry the joy of the Lord in you. You are like a vial of oil. Of happy juice. How funny. If it hasn't, it's going to catch you at the grocery store and in restaurants. People are going to be uncomfortable, but that's okay. The uncomfortable feeling that they're going to wrestle with is not because they're embarrassed by your laughter. They are uncomfortable because within your laughter, they hear they're convicted. They hear the voice of God warning them, pointing at their sin. While others who will laugh with you because we're all under the same blood. But those who aren't are going to feel strong conviction. There is a shadow. The Lord is showing me there is a shadow. It's a shadow that walks behind you, not closely, but in the distance. It is a spirit. and is attached to your relatives somehow. And it wants to wrap its arms around you, but it's mad because it can't catch up with you. It can't get its hands on you. This is why the Holy Ghost is laughing at the devil, because he's going, ha ha, you can't catch her because I've got my arm around her. Yeah, you're going to start really seeing miracles and healing go on in your life and in your ministry when you pray for people. It's going to happen. Everybody shout, it's going to happen. Oh, you don't shout good enough for me in Oklahoma. It's going to happen. Hallelujah. Can I pray for your wife? Come here. Stop right there. I'll come to you in a minute. Lift your hands up and say, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Okay, so not like this. I see the joy all over you. I see you laughing. I see you giggling. I see you giggling with your three fingers over your lips. And you're doing this, trying to hold it in. But you're not going to hold this in. It's going to, if you hold it in, it'll come out your ears. Hallelujah. There's a young person that's really dear to you that's in trouble. And God has when you laugh, it really has to be God, because you're screaming on the inside. Don't let my baby go over the cliff. Pentecost, like I did, then you will have heard several times God can't, he won't force people to get saved. I still believe that, but I also believe, and I've always believed, he can allow certain things to happen they wish to God they were.